it's wonderful to talk to you today. Rehearsal sounded fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
You're preparing for a tour for We Are Born.
Yes.
Tell me a bit about the title of the album.
It was because the last album was called Some People Have Real Problems, and I answered why it was called that probably 32 or 42,000 times. And so this time I just called the album the first lyric of the first song.
Yeah, where was the inspiration for the songs? I know you're a balladeer.
Yeah, I write ballads a lot, and that's because they're easier. And that's not because I didn't ever write pop songs. It was because to some degree I wrote my first album, or the one that I like to call my first album, is called Healing is Difficult. That was in the urban section. And I was hanging out with hip-hoppers, like Australian hip-hoppers, so I made that record. I think I'm just really impressionable. And then the next record, I was kind of sad, and I was hanging out with 07, who only listened to James Taylor. And so I made Colour the Small One. And then I tried to deliver a pop record. I felt better. I wrote a bunch of up-tempo pop songs that I absolutely loved with Greg Kirsten, who ended up producing this record. And I went to Universal and I was so proud. I was look what I've made you. And I brought them this pop record and they were what are you talking about? You can't do this. And I was why? What do you mean? Why? And they were you're a down-tempo artist. You're part of 07. You've done Colour the Small One. You can't do this. And I was ouch. And then I said, I was stubborn and I said, I don't care. This is what I'm delivering. And they were you're dropped. So they dropped me, and 2 weeks later, the 6 feet under thing happened, where they used Breathe Me in the final episode. And gratefully, I had the record back, so I ran across to America, and I licensed it through Astralworks, and that happened. And then I guess I asked around, and everybody said, yeah, you should make another down-tempo record. Maybe you can put some mid-tempo songs on there, and maybe that can lead you to making the up-tempo record that you've wanted to make for a long time. So I made Some People Have Real Problems as a segue into the record that I delivered to Universal 5 years ago. And my favourite part of the story is that Universal were one of the three labels that were in a bidding war over this record that they dropped me over 5 years ago. Isn't life weird?
So you've been collaborating a lot.
Yes. Here's what happened with Christina Aguilera. I don't know how it happened with Natasha Bedingfield. Mm-hmm. I can't really remember. I think we knew someone that was similar and that they hooked us up or said that she wanted to write with me, mm-hmm. and so I did. With Will Young, he was working with my old producer, Jimmy Hogarth, or Sam Dixon, my bass player, and he wanted to do some writing, so I did with him. But with Christina, when she eventually called and we got in touch with each other on the phone, her management, my management, kissy kissy, mm-hmm. and then us on the phone, and she was I've been a fan of yours since 07 days, and I want to know if you want to collaborate with me. And I was let me think. $1 million. Yes. Yeah, it was really good. It was a really good experience. She's really easy to work with. She's not controlling. She's not dominant. She's the boss, and I kind of like that. I like having a boss. It was nice, because I have to be the boss of lots of things, and so it's really nice when somebody else is just I'm not feeling that word, can we use the word lioness, can we do this, can we do that, and I'm yeah.
Did you grow up in a musical household?
Yes, my dad was a guitarist and my mum played bass. First they were hippies and then they were rockabillies and punks.
So it was the music that you liked listening to when you were young, or that you grew up around?
I grew up on the Stray Cats and Motown and The Police and The Pretenders, and then Madonna and Cyndi Lauper and New Edition and Pass the Dutchie and some hip-hop. And then I was in a hip-hop, I was in a breakdancing crew, and I was just the little person that they would swing around on their head like the helicopter, and I'd be woo! And then they'd swing me around by my ankles and stuff, and we were even on a television show once, because we were, we're in Adelaide, Australia, population 1 million. And it was that I was a B-girl, growing up.
Fantastic. So, but you're often described as having a jazz sound, so you weren't growing up around jazz?
No, nothing. I mean, when I turned maybe 17, I heard about Keith Jarrett, and I got the Cologne concert from 74, and that's the only piece of... I think, is it called Kind of Blue or Some Kind of Blue, Miles Davis? I don't even know. How embarrassing. I don't know anything about music. And, that Miles Davis record, those are the only two pieces of jazz I've ever owned.
So the soulful sound is Motown influenced, or is it spontaneous?
Because I was obsessive as a kid, so mm-hmm. I used to have a cassette player, and I would just record just the parts of songs that I liked. So, like I liked The Doors, I liked that. And then it would go. So I'd just have that for 30 minutes on the tape, and I'd just listen to that because that was what I liked the most. So I was obsessive in the sense that I'd try and sing along with whoever I was listening to until you couldn't really tell that I was singing along. So I was a mimic. And I think that when I started writing original material, that what happened was just like an amalgamation of all the people that I was trying to mimic growing up.
Much of your sound is so deeply felt, emotional. What are you thinking when you're on stage?
Depending on what's happening in my life, sometimes I feel like I re-experience it. It's like re-traumatizing myself all over again. Or other times I'll be thinking about my shopping list or like, but for the most part, I'm just not really there.
It sounds like it could be meditative.
It is.
Yeah.
I think that's part of what I like about it.
Yeah. Last year you told The Advocate that you wanted to live in the country, yes. Have babies, yes. And play Scrabble constantly.
I do. I've added to that list.
Yeah.
I want to wear like triangle dresses and Birkenstocks. And what else? Maybe I want to just like have thousands of dogs, like rescue thousands of dogs on top of that. But now JD and I have been talking about babies. We've got narrowed it down to 4 sperm donors on Zytex.com, which is a sperm bank place. And we've got enhanced profiles and everything. So you get like baby photos, adult photos, like parental health medical history, like grandparental medical histories. So, you know, we're just going for people who don't have like mental illness in the family. Plenty of that over here. We don't need any more of that. Just people with small foreheads, tall, you know, just trying to like even it out.
So I've got a few questions related to that. You're planning it for a family. And
yes.
this is in the planning stages.
Absolutely, because David 2 years ago, my manager, said to me, I said, when can I have a baby? And he said September 2010. And now he gets all slanty eyed on me and he's like, no, I don't think so. I don't think you can. I think you'll have to wait until March.
So you're in the carrier.
Can wait. I might. Yeah, I'll be the carrier. Yeah, JD's kind of like, she's a bit of a unicorn. I don't know. I don't think she'd feel like comfortable being the carrier.
You've called her your boyfriend.
Yeah. Well, she's like the warlock, and I'm like the witch.
Mm-hmm.
She's like Mr. Boop, and I'm Mrs. Boop.
Was the sense of gender expression something that you thought consciously about when you got together, or did it sort of...
I didn't even know anything about it.
Yeah.
Like, I had been in relationships with dudes, so I just, when I saw her picture, I thought she was a dude, and then I clicked on it, MySpace, and I was like, because I'd gone like, cute boy, click, oh, cute girl, and then I was like, find her. So I booked her to play like DJ after one of my gigs. It was really sleazy, sort of casting couch grossness.
Very professional.
Anyway, now she is mine. so yeah, I didn't really care. She taught me everything I know. Like, I didn't know that things could be emasculating. I didn't know that, you know, that it's a really sensitive subject, like how you see yourself and how you wish to be seen by others, you know?
In the past, you've said you weren't really a fan of labels when it comes to sexual orientation. Is that still how you feel about it?
Yeah, the weird thing is that because JD's such a unicorn and I don't really know if she's a boy or a girl and neither does she, like, it's like, well, so it's weird, like the whole marriage issue and civil rights and stuff, because as a straight person, I'm like really embarrassed about it. I think it's so embarrassing that like gay people still can't get married and don't have the same rights and we pay the same taxes and blah, blah, blah. And then as a gay person, I feel enraged. So it's weird because I really feel like I have a really unique perspective that I feel like I'm genuinely both. And I guess that I will be for the rest of my life, because it's really, neither of us need JD to decide whether she's male or female.
The video for Buttons is a lot of fun. It's a bit ridiculous.
It's awesome,
cute.
Isn't it? It's my favorite video I ever did make.
Yeah?
Yep.
Tell me why.
It's just weird. It's weird and it's perfect and it was cheap and it was just a great idea and it was simple and smart and...
Your face is distorted throughout it. And if you wanted to, you could sort of read it as a bit of a poke in the eye to the music industry that would want you to be presented in a certain way.
Well, I think Chris was really into that idea. I never really thought of it like that. The truth is that it was my discomfort with fame and being recognized. So, like, for the majority of my videos, I've had like something like distorting or covering my face. But yeah, I liked it when people thought that was, you know, a political statement, because it made me seem smarter than I actually am. High ten, sister.